afternoon and welcome to today's sessions, GMB's webinar entitled Understanding the Vulnerabilities in Connecting Vehicles. My name is Victoria and I will be the moderator of the session. First of all, on behalf of the organizers, I would like to thank you all for attending the session today. I welcome those who have just joined again. I remind you again that you can ask your questions in the control panel during the webinar so that they can be answered at the end of the presentation. If you don't have time to ask all of them, contact information will be provided at the end of the presentation. The speakers who will give today's session are Belén Andrino, GMB's Manager of Automotive Business Development, and Marco Donadio, GMB's Security Project Manager and Business Development Manager. Before asking Belén to speak, I would like to take this opportunity of giving a short presentation of both. Belén Andrino is an industrial engineer from the University of Valladolid. She started working as quality manager in 2002, and since then, she has always carried out technical duties such as quality and project manager, as well as sales manager within multinational automotive companies. She joined GMB in 2019, where she works as business development manager for all activities concerning connected and autonomous vehicle technology. She works from the automotive business unit while liaising frequently with the cybersecurity and GNSS departments. Marco Donadio is an electronics engineer from the Polytechnic University of Turin, and he received a master in telecommunications from the Polytechnic University of Barcelona. He joined GMB in 2008. Right from the start, he was involved in several connected and autonomous vehicle projects, gaining valuable experience in Japan, working as a resident engineer in a Japanese OEM. His current work focuses on vehicle cybersecurity for both services and products. He is also a member of the Spanish Working Group for the Cybersecurity Regulation, ISO 21434. So, Belén, the floor is yours.
So, thank you very much, Victoria, for your nice explanation and introduction. Good morning or afternoon, everybody, depending on where you are located today. And let me also thank you for your attendance at this webinar. I will start my explanation introducing who we are at this automotive business unit. Let me explain you that we provide with technological solutions, all of them related to the connected and autonomous vehicles. Our deep experience comes from more than 35 years ago, when the company started our activities mainly related to the aerospace, cybersecurity, and defense areas. And since then, some other divisions have been incorporated to our footprint, taking advantage of the different synergies that these sectors have. And since more than 15 years now, our automotive business unit is running. Up to now, we can say that more than 4 million vehicles incorporate our embedded telematics software. Also, as required by our customers, we are certified on CMMI Level 5 and Automotive Spice Level 3. And also, we are members of standardization committees, either for GNSS and for cybersecurity, concerning, for example, the ISO 21434 that my colleague Marco will explain to us later, as well as the WP29. So, at this slide, you can see the structure of this webinar, where we will start with an introduction followed by a description of the key factors that are associated with car attacks. And then we will see, I think, the most interesting part of this webinar, which are the practical examples of some car attacks that we have produced internally at our cybersecurity laboratory. And then we will give you some conclusions, as well as some time to ask you for questions or comments and discuss at the end of this webinar. So why do we need cybersecurity in vehicles? It's mainly due to two factors that we can say. First, that the increasing connectivity in vehicles is a key point, as more than 500 million vehicles will be connected in 2025. According to a study done by Pricewaterhouse, and also around 80 million autonomous vehicles with autonomy level 4 and 5 will be running in 2030. Additionally, we are experiencing a software complexity due to the increasing number of code lines, as more than 100 million lines are installed in each vehicle as data from 2015. And if we compare this figure with the one from aircrafts, we can say that aircrafts have around 20 million lines. So this is a huge quantity compared with aircrafts. So this increased number leads to a higher number of bugs, interfaces, protocols, vulnerabilities, and ports and attacks. So that's the figures we are taking into account. If we come into the bottom of this slide, there's some key figures of the history of the most famous car attacks up to now, where we can highlight these points. First attacks were noted in 2012, but before that, we discovered that due to some researchers' studies, that since 2009 we were having car attack, cybersecurity attacks, mainly due to the fact that the operating system is common between IT and cars. So we can think that car attacks in vehicles come before 2012. Since then, we can talk about attacks such as Busov, infotainment attacks, cellular GSM connections, that these three of them will be explained to you later in this cybersecurity laboratory that you will watch some videos. So these were initial car attacks at the very beginning. And also after that, we have experienced physical attacks such as OBD, relay attacks, smartphone applications. It's important to highlight that when we talk about smartphones, we need to cyber secure the end-to-end system, as the vulnerabilities can happen in smartphones, in the connectivity, and in the server. So we need to ensure the complete end-to-end system that we will see this later. And also, it's important to highlight that at the very beginning, attacks were more physical, and then they have become more wireless attacks due to the increasing technological complexity that we are having in vehicles, such as wireless, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, etc. So now, my colleague Marco will start with the second section of this webinar, where you might learn about the main car attacks that might happen in vehicles.
Okay, thank you, Belén, for this introduction. And hello, everybody. I can see that there are people connected from many countries. So hello, everybody. So let me give you some additional detail about this key factor associated with car attacks, and then we can see. I will show some practical example from some video from our laboratory. So as commented before, so the car is a complex connectivity system. There are so many electronic components, many interfaces, port, protocol. So it means that the attack surface is getting bigger, and all the attack vectors are also increasing due to the complexity of technology and due to the connectivity system, autonomous driving. We can see the vehicle like a PC or a computer, or like a network that with the computer connected, because each ECU, each electronic ECU, is a computer with the operating system, with application, with protocol, with interfaces. And everything is connected. So we can say that all the vulnerability from the IT world or IoT, or most of them, can be migrated or can be applied to the vehicle. This is important because there are so many databases for the vulnerability from the IT world, and nowadays can be used for the car attack. For example, imagine vulnerability on the operating system like Linux, Android, or well, I remember that some infotainment system was even integrating a Microsoft CE operating system, very old or legacy operating system. So the vulnerability is there, and not only for the operating system, also for the standard protocol and interfaces like Wi-Fi, cellular, Bluetooth. So this is something that is coming from the IT world. This is like an ecosystem that need the security. And of course, if we talk about vulnerability in vehicle, we talk about the complete platform or complete end-to-end system, not only the single ECU, but also the complete architecture, the vehicle, and also the smartphone and the server. Because now with the connected vehicle is we are talking about a complete platform. Another important key factor is that in the automotive, usually the life of vehicle is around 10 years. In US, I think it's even more, it's around 15 years. In my family or many friends that I have, they have a vehicle that is around 10 years. So imagine that this vehicle have a legacy system installed. So it means with old operating system, with the legacy vulnerability, and most of them cannot be updated for any reason, because there is no possibility to update over the air, or because the system is so old that there is no any patch or any updating for this application. Another important point is also the cost. So security means cost. So you need to pay the security. We pay security in every area. For private security, we pay a price. For alarm security at home, we also pay. So security also in vehicles should be paid. If you apply the security, but if we apply the security from the beginner, and we can save money later because we will not need to pay the cost for mitigation or for to fix the vulnerability, or even the cost for updating the software by the recall channel. That is something very, very painful for the OEMs and supplier. And finally, another important comment is that to understand the trade-off between safety and security. Security is important to assure the safety in vehicle. So in autonomous driving application, safety is mandatory. Security, applying the security, we need to avoid any attack that can affect the safety in vehicle. Later, I will show some example to better understand this topic, that is about the GPS spoofing attack. And well, safety and security, I think I can see that there are some Italian and Spanish connected. So even in our language, there is only one word to say safety and security. We cannot, there is no difference, no? Sicurezza and seguridad. I don't know if I'm wrong, let me know in the chat. Okay, then in this slide, I will show some example of a attack vector for the vehicle. As I said before, the vehicle is like a computer network. There are several attack vectors that can be even classified like a local vector or physical access. we can start with the OBD port, that is a very standard vector, or it's very very famous in the automotive application. By OBD port, we can get physical access to the internal communication. We can obtain access to the system, to the ECU. We can get sensitive data or vehicle. We can create exploit or attack to manipulate the vehicle communication. And there are so many other examples that we can explain with the OBD port. We have also a video explaining or showing the OBD port attack. The wireless interface or the wireless vector is also a standard attack vector. The Wi-Fi and Bluetooth interface, so there are so several vulnerabilities in these protocols. We can create, for example, a point-to-point connection with the infotainment system. We can gain the access remotely to the vehicle through this interface. We can bypass the privilege and get the control of the complete system in the vehicle. We also have another example video showing how we can make this we can take this control using the wireless interface. The telematic control unit, the TCU, that I think was one of the first external access for the vehicle. They said that was very dangerous ECU. The hacker or the attacker can get access to the cellular network and gain access to the vehicle. It's another example of wireless or remote attack. Another famous or standard attack vector is the passive key entry or the digital key. The system to open and close the door remotely. That can be by phone, by digital key, by card, NFC card. There are some famous attacks that are called the relay station attack, replay attack, or man in the middle, where the attacker is sniffing the communication between the digital key and the vehicle, is stalling the correct key and using a different hardware, and use this key to open the vehicle later on remotely. Then, a part of this standard attack vector, we can also include the attack from the external communication, that including the cloud-based platform and the smartphone application. Because now when we talk about connected vehicle, is not only the vehicle, it's also smartphone application and the server. The vulnerability in the smartphone application can affect also the system in vehicle. I think you remember the famous attack at Nissan Leaf in 2016. There was a vulnerability in the application, so the user was controlling the electric vehicle function by the application. Each user was registering or was logged in with authentication to the application. Each login was associated to the VIN number of the vehicle. But due to some bug or vulnerability in the application, the user was able to change the VIN number in the application, and using the current privilege of the login, was able to access to any vehicle remotely. So even if the TCU, the telematic control unit, or if the web cloud were developed with the secure requirement, due to this vulnerability in the application, there was a massive attack, because the user that have the login in the application was able to just writing the VIN or changing the VIN was able to control the other vehicle. And this is an example to have the security in the complete end-to-end platform. Okay. Now let's make this webinar more interesting. So using some practical example. So in the following slide, I collect a few video from our car hacking laboratory. In GMV, we perform pen testing for automotive application for different attack vector. Usually when the customer asks to make a cybersecurity auditory, what we do is performing pen testing in a single ECU, in the software application, in the complete vehicle, complete platform. And here I will show just a few examples of a hacking car. We make this this pen testing times ago. We already informed the OEM about this vulnerability. So this vulnerability are already mitigated or fixed. So I can tell you that if you recognize the vehicle, don't worry, this is already fixed. Now we are working with a new model, new vehicle that have more function, also including the autonomous driving function. So I can tell you that the new vehicle have more vulnerability, even more interesting. But well, today we cannot show for some confidential topic. But if you are interested, well, you can contact us and we can discuss about this. If you have some question about any kind of question, you can just write in the chat. I will try to check later after the webinar, and I think there will be also a session for question and answer. This is the first example that I want to show to you. This is a typical physical attack, local attack, using the OBD port. In this attack, what we were doing, we were connecting, we connect to the OBD port of the vehicle, the onboard diagnostic port of the vehicle. We were sniffed all the CAN bus message. Then we made a kind of a reverse engineering just to understand the signal and create a kind of a CAN bus map just to understand what and to take all the information that was used for the create the exploit. In this case, we were using some message from the BCM. And let me see, I will show you the video. We create our hardware connected to the OBD port. We were just sending some message in order to make a denied or service of the BCM. So the BCM, you can see that here, the BCM is automatically disabled due to the CAN state error, CAN bus off. Then in parallel, we were sending, thanks to that, with our hardware platform, a message that we were creating previously, sending some message to change, for example, the speed of the vehicle. The vehicle here, the car is stopped. So we stop, but you can see that the speed is changing because we are sending this this fake message to the CAN bus. And also we send some message in order to change the notification, like the engine alert notification, or even here the gasoline notification. Here we change or configure it, or set the level of gasoline to zero. Okay. In this case, for some alerts, for some notification, we were able to reset just performing an engine off on cycle, but for some alert displaying on the cluster, like the gasoline level, the gasoline level was not able to. We were not able to reset just with a reset. So we went to the dealer, and the dealer needs to reset all the ECU. Okay. Then Another attack is the GPS spoofing that I want to show. This is also a standard attack, and it's quite famous. The idea of this attack is to inhibit or to jamming the real GPS signal, and to transmit a fake GPS signal using a simulator or a GPS base. Or GPS simulator that is sending a fake location. The navigator is receiving the fake GPS signal. Also, the navigator is receiving the fake GPS signal and is showing the localization that we are simulating from the PC. So you can see that. Here we have our navigator. Here is the our simulator hardware sending fake location. Here the navigation is showing some location in Madrid, I think, but actually the car is in the parking. It's stopped. It's parking in GMV facility, and the event with the door open, but the navigator is still showing that we are moving. This most of you maybe can think that this is an attack that is not affecting the user, but many times it could happen that with the Google Map or even with your smartphone that is getting crazy because there is some fake location, or when the GPS signal is not good, or you lost signal. This is okay. I agree that it's not affecting the safety, but imagine that instead of navigator, we are spoofing the signal from the autonomous driving ECU. So the system of autonomous driving is using the GPS signal to calculate the precision, and the precision should be less than 10 less than centimeter. So imagine that if we are sending fake GPS signal, or we are modifying this GPS signal for an autonomous drive, this is very, very dangerous and can affect the safety of the vehicle. Okay. The other attack is that I want to show is this is also another physical attack that is through the infotainment system. In this example, we are connected with the infotainment system and our PC through the Ethernet connection. We were able to debug the kernel, modifying the configuration of kernel, change some parameter in the operating system, and also we were able to disable the wireless authentication. Once we were connected physically to the navigator, we were able to open the port and get the disable the authentication from the wireless interface. So we were able to connect remotely from the PC to the infotainment system through the Wi-Fi connection. Then we realized that the infotainment system was directly connected to the CAN bus signal. Especially, we were able to check the CAN bus or the signal from the park assistant function. So what we were doing was sniffed all the CAN bus signal from this park assistant function, making a reverse engineering to create an exploit for the CAN bus, and remotely connected with the vehicle. We were able to control the vehicle remotely through the Wi-Fi. was quite scared for the driver. So you can see here that our colleague is connected remotely with the PC to the infotainment system, the Wi-Fi, and sending the exploit, changing the CAN signal for the park assistant function, and the vehicle was moving along. Okay. So was a quite scary and dangerous example. Okay. Then for the next example, it's another a remote attack that is related to the cellular communication. Just one question. Let me ask you: what do you think about the GSM communication or the 2G vulnerability? If you think that is still a real issue, a real vulnerability for connected vehicle, or do you think that since we have the most advanced technology like 4G, 3G, and now even the 5G, is not we cannot be aware of this. So if you have some comment, let me know in the chat, because I wanted to check. Okay. Yeah, I think most of you, well, some of you said yes, other, well, one said no, but yeah. So let me say that this is a vulnerability that is still in the vehicle, because several vehicles still use the whole old modem that have that supporting the GSM connection. Most of the telematic control units support the 2G communication, and the 2G communication is not providing a network authentication. This is due to some design limitation. So we make an experiment using a TCU in a vehicle. The vehicle was a vehicle from our colleague at GMV. It was an electric vehicle. It was not so old. The vehicle was four or 5 years old. Make this test in Spain. So at first, the TCU was connected to the network, to the 3G or 4G network. We were using a signal inhibitor to jump the signal. So the vehicle lost the connection. And in parallel, what we were doing was using a GSM base station. This is a 2G, a GSM simulator that we also use for other tests, equal test, or just for like a base station. Here there is our colleague Miroslav that was making this test, so connecting, creating this 2G fake base station. The vehicle now, since since lost the connection due to the signal inhibitor, automatically connect to the 2G fake base station. We create the channel for the communication. We take the control, so we were able to sniff or to get many important or sensitive data from the communication from the vehicle, from the TCU, like the IMEA of the SIM card, even the phone number. Then we realized that in this telematic control unit there was a eCall function. So the eCall function in some model, in some TCU, the call function have a requirement that is called the callback function. So when there is a call to the emergency number, the 112, if the communication is lost due to any kind of issue, the 112 automatically call the vehicle, and the vehicle automatically answer and open the audio channel. So what we were doing here was making a fake call through the 112, because this GSM simulator have also the function to send a call. The telematic control unit receive this 112 call, automatically answer, automatically open the audio channel, And we were able to listen all the conversation in the call. Fortunately, we informed our colleague, but imagine that our colleague was talking about sensitive conversation. Okay? So this is something that is also sensitive, and it's quite scary for the privacy of the people. After showing some practical example, I hope that was interesting. If you have question, please let me know. Let's see very quickly what we need to do in order to avoid this vulnerability and how to mitigate them. I will not enter in a deep detail because this is just a quick introduction. This is a very huge topic, and if you are interested, you can contact us later. So at first, it's important to have a complete cybersecurity services integrated in your company. The importance of developing a secure system in order to avoid vulnerability in vehicle. So this start from have a complete secure life, secure life cycle services. Ideally, all the connected vehicle should be continually monitored to protect, detect, and mitigate the cybersecurity attack. So what we can do is have a good cybersecurity assessment. That is an important step. During the design, it's important to review all the requirements, make a vulnerability analysis of the system at any kind of level, hardware, software, application, operating system, system in general. It's important also the risk analysis. It's important to make a complete risk analysis documentation. This is something also request from the new cybersecurity regulation for automotive, such as the UNIC WB 29, that, as you probably already know, last June, the UNIC released this new regulation to ensure the cybersecurity in vehicle. This regulation is already set for implementation in Europe, starting from 2022. But in Japan and Korea, they will start from next year already. In GMV, we can support the OEMs and supplier on the best way, adding cybersecurity layer and in vehicle, without risking the project timetable, that is important, and of course adding in an unnecessary cost, because cost is also important. Then the other regulation is the standard ISO 21434. This standard is more focused on the process and to have a properly processed through the life cycle of the vehicle, in order to protect the from the cyber attack. Both regulation, we can say that are complementary, because both are checking the security in the modern vehicle. And in GMB, we are also a part of a working group for a Spanish working group for this ISO. I think this ISO, the release will be, well, the estimation time was end of this year, but most probably will be the first quarter of next year. Another important task for cybersecurity in vehicle is the testing. Pen testing is very important in order to discover all the vulnerability in vehicle. It's also important to have a properly tool for forensic analysis, or tool also for traceability of the vulnerability, traceability of the any kind of attacks. All these services should be applied to to the project from a scratch. When you start to developing a project, it's important. But also when you have an integration project, when you make integration of, for example, an infotainment system with the telematic control unit, or integration of software in a specific ECU. So it's also very important. And of course, the in a complete platform. It should be the end-to-end platform. Also the cyber intelligence is a complementary service. In GMV, we have a security operation center that is located in GMV facility. And in order to properly respond for an incident or vulnerability in a short time. Very, very quickly, because I think also time is, we don't have so much time. So in this slide, I just want to focus the message for security by design. That is important. So especially when we are developing the software. Most of bug or vulnerability are coming from software design. It doesn't mean that the hardware is vulnerability free, because there are also several hardware vulnerability in vehicle. But as you know, software is a sensitive piece of design. And so it's important to secure the complete development life cycle of software. Here, there is just a list of few rules that our team gave me, our software team developer, just the rules that how to develop a secure software design. Also, testing is important. We already said important, as explained before, at any software layer in this case. So operating system, application, kernel, any layer. I think that the designs should be, I think that the software developer should have also a high level of or skill in cybersecurity, because developer security, we need to develop security as a service. So actually in GMV, we have the software developer that also have the cybersecurity skill. And in other case, we have a team, cybersecurity team, that is supervising the developing of a secure software. Then last part, I will try to go quickly, is discussing or showing you the complementary part for the cybersecurity service that are the product. Because we a part of services, we can also complement this cybersecurity assessment with some product. In this case is the IDPS, the Intrusion Detection and Prevention System. We have in GMV, we have an IDPS that is a software-based IDPS. It's a software that can be integrated in any kind of ECU. In order to monitorize the internal communication, CAN bus, Ethernet, USB. This is a machine learning algorithm. It's also patented by GMV and also used for other different applications. This algorithm, what it's doing is monitoring the in-vehicle communication. Once detect some intrusion or some vulnerability or some violation or anomaly in the communication, send automatically a notification to a server. This server will make all the data processing, also using machine learning rules, classifying the intrusion, understanding also the level of safety of the intrusion, and creating the prevention, because prevention is also sensitive, because imagine that there is some vulnerability in the BCM, like we saw before. We cannot make prevention just disable the BCM, because then we cannot use the brake system of the vehicle. So taking in account also the safety topic. And another product is the secure digital key. We said before that the digital key have several vulnerability, like the replay attack, relay station attack, man in the middle. We develop some a software that is also patented by GMB. It's a software that can be integrated in the smartphone and also in the ECU in order to mitigate this vulnerability in the communication, in the, basically in the Bluetooth and wireless communication. This is something patented by GMB, but we can say that we use also the some boundary localization for mitigating this vulnerability. If you need more more detail, maybe we can. Well, you can ask, and we can discuss later. I think it's all for my part. Maybe Belen, if you wanna continue for the last part, mm-hmm. last slide.
Okay, thank you, Marco, for your interesting explanation, mainly regarding to our laboratory. So just to give you a general overview of our activities at the automotive business unit, let me inform you that our footprint is composed by four branches, where cybersecurity is one of them. And cybersecurity is not operating as just as a branch, because it gives support to the three of them, to the ECU development, connectivity, and GNSS applications or services. So this is also a transversal support from cybersecurity. If we talk very quickly about these other three branches, first of all, on your left bottom, you've got the ECU development, either the hardware and also the software. If you remember from the very first part of the presentation of this webinar of today, we talk about more than 4 million vehicles already incorporating our embedded telematic software. So this would be included in this branch at this point. The third one is related to connectivity. Here we develop solutions either for mobility, e-tolling, pay-per-use, GNSS services in highways, also remote applications, electric vehicle services. And another one that is very, very important at this connectivity branch is the one related to cooperative services, where we locate the CB2X services, including a project that we are working with that is named C-Roads, and that we are working here in Spain and also in Portugal, and is an important project regarding this connectivity or cooperative services. And this project in Spain is about to end, and we are collecting the final results of this project for CB2X. And the fourth one would be related to the GNSS precise and highly precise and safe positioning solutions based on GNSS. Here we incorporate the synergies coming from our colleagues from aerospace, and we are giving here either the correction services for those signals received from the GNSS satellites that need to be corrected, together with the embedded software that it would be embedded into the vehicle that we call we name positioning engine, and that provides with the different performance that are required for these autonomous vehicles. And that we are already developing an important project at this point for an important OEM. If we jump into the very last one, just to summarize what we have been talking today at this webinar, we have different vulnerabilities in vehicles. You have seen the explanation from Marco, including all the key factors and the different vulnerabilities that may happen, and that as we are increasing the complexity in terms of connectivity and autonomous and technological solutions in vehicles, these vulnerabilities are increasing. But in parallel, we can really ensure that we need to be positive, as most of them are already detected, analyzed, and mitigated. So car hacking is not is no longer a proof of concept. It's something that we really know, and we really can say that we can mitigate. So and also we really think that next years will be very, very interesting, as the connectivity in vehicles will provide us with more information and more tools to discover in terms of cybersecurity. So now it's the time for your questions at this webinar. So let me also introduce again Victoria, our moderator of today.
Thank you, Belén. And thank you, Marco. It was really interesting. Now, as Belén said, we are opening the round of questions that Marco and Belén will answer. And if you want to ask anything in this space, it's the moment. So we have received a few questions. The first one is from Giovanni. And Giovanni asked that regarding the OBD port attack, if this port is used in the vehicle and it is mandatory, how can we avoid attack to these interfaces?
Can you repeat the question, Vero? Sorry that I'm taking note.
Yes. So Giovanni asks that regarding the OBD port attack, if this port is used in the vehicle and it is mandatory, how can we avoid attack to these interfaces?
Okay, maybe I can answer, Belén, if you don't mind.
Yes, sure. Thank you.
So, well, I think if question is if we can avoid the use of OBD. So the OBD is a mandatory, at least at the moment, because it's onboard diagnostic port. What we can do for mitigate or for avoid vulnerability through the OBD port is something that I think is already doing in the new vehicle architecture. What they are doing is making a distributed network using different gateway. So in this case, what you can do is just isolating the safety ECU, filtering the safety message, and making like a safe, safe box network. So you have several different network inside the vehicle, and you can leave the OBD port just for a diagnostic, or even you can have the canout indication with OBD port. So this could be, I think, some prevention system for the OBD port attack, or even you can install some IDPS just in the OBD bus.
Okay, perfect. Then Maria asked, like, does cybersecurity regulation are already mandatory in automotive?
I can answer this question, Marco, if you are fine with that.
Yes.
Okay. So we can say for the moment, neither of them are still mandatory. If we talk about UNICEW P29, I also think that Marco mentioned this this figure before, but it was published in June this year, and the forecast is that it would be mandatory in Japan and in Korea next year, in January 2021, and after that it would be mandatory in Europe. So we are talking about 2022 for this WP 29. If we talk about ISO 21434, It's foreseen to be published at the end of this year or beginning of the next one. We are having delay in this publication due to the times that we are living this year. And the forecast is not confirmed yet, but it should be in 2024 that it would be mandatory. But in parallel, apart from these regulations that would be mandatory in the next years, we are having some guidelines such as AutoISAC or SAE J3061 and some others that are working as guidelines or as best practices for the moment for those that you might be interested in some regulations. So these are not mandatory as well, but they act as guidelines for us.
Perfect. Then Daniel says, what do you mean by car hacking is no longer a proof of concept?
Well, I think because I think Belén was explaining at the beginner that there were several attacks done by research people, and there are. Let me see. Sorry. And basically there are several companies that are making this cybersecurity attack like a proof of concept, showing that they can attack the vehicle, just to showing the vulnerability. But now it's not longer a proof of concept because it's something real that we need to take into account.
Thank you, Marco. I think that I explained that before the first attacks found on the keyless systems for car entry for BMW, researchers had found around 2009 some studies of some vulnerabilities that were not existing at that moment in vehicles, but just after that they were really real attacks, no, starting 2012 more or less.
Okay, another question is, how can GPS spoofing attack can be prevented?
I think that there are several answers for this, but I can tell you that GPS spoofing attack can be prevented in a software design at first. We are working, for example, in a project that is a GNSS for autonomous driving, and it's mandatory to implement a spoofing, anti-spoofing, and anti-jammer in the very low layer of the software. So should be integrated in the software layer. Mm-hmm. I think that to tell you how to prevent or how to create this anti-spoofing, it's very technically, so maybe we can discuss later. But basically, I can tell you that it's better to do and can be done at software layer in the application.
Mm-hmm. Okay, another question from George is, do you have solutions for PKES and smartphone-based car access preventing replay MITM attacks?
I think we were just discussing in this slide. I was showing, I was showing the product. So the product that is the secure digital key. So this is a solution that is actually the one that is used for preventing the replay, relay, and the middle in the wild, man in the middle attack. This is a software base that can be integrated in the smartphone, on the ECU. We have this solution.
Okay. Another question is, the IDS system can be installed in a legacy vehicle without modifying the car interfaces?
I can answer this question, Marco. Here, it depends on the architecture of the vehicle, because we're talking about legacy vehicles that can be really different among them. For example, there are the ones that had only one CAN interface, so all the CAN bus network might be protected with a simple IDS intrusion detection system connected to the OBD port or any other CAN ports. So in this case, which are the easiest ones, they can be protected with just with a simple IDS system. So they can be protected as well.
Okay, so we have reached the closing time of the webinar. We have time for two more questions, but if you have more questions, you can send them as shown on the... Please, can you, Marco, put the last slide with the... with automotive direction. We have time for two more questions, and if you have more questions, you can send them to the direction shown on your screen. So two more questions. Angeles asks, if some countries are not supporting GSM anymore, should the GSM vulnerability mitigate it anywhere?
There are some countries, I think, like Japan. Japan, the GSM is not supporting since long time, more than 10 years ago. And I think there will be the fall down of 2G in US also soon. Mm-hmm. Even if the communication is not, let's say, not working. But still, as I said before, the modem is still supporting the 2G communication. So let's say the vulnerability is there. So even if you don't have a connection in your country, if your telematic device is supporting the 2G communication, so there is a way to exploit this vulnerability, because you can go with some jamming hardware, jamming the signal, the 3G, 4G, or 5G signal, and make a fake connection with the 2G communication with your modem.
Okay, and the last question is the GPS spoofing attack video a real threat for vehicle, or just an attack to manipulate the location on your Navy system?
Can you read again? Sorry.
Yes. Is the GPS spoofing attack video a real threat for vehicle, or just an attack to manipulate the location on your Navy system?
Okay. So, in the example was just a GPS. So you see the navigator in vehicle, and the car was stopped. And we were making the attack through the PC, but you can imagine a real attack can be car by car. Imagine that I have my system to make the my GPS simulator in my vehicle, and I can spoofing the signal of the vehicle close to me. This could be a real vehicle. But as I said before, in this case, we are just spoofing the GPS from a navigator. But imagine that there is the ECU with the autonomous driving system spoofing the signal from this ECU. So it will be very dangerous.
Okay, so I think that we can close the session. We remind you that in a few days we will share this webinar on GMB social networks, especially on YouTube, Twitter, and LinkedIn. I would like to invite you to answer a survey that you will receive in the follow-up email later today or tomorrow, as said before. And related to this topic, GMB is also organizing on October 14 the webinar entitled Satellite Navigation to Enable the Way from Science Fiction to the Next Generation of Autonomous Car. And in GMB social networks, you will be able to find the link for the registration. So thank you so much for your attendance.
Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.